Zoom sessions. I hope you enjoyed the tacos. I did. I want to thank Alex and Kate who helped bring that together for us. You all did a great job at picking up your prizes. However, is Nathan Patterson here? Okay, we got your Acture, you won an Acture license, so why don't you get it right now? Oh, look at this, another Acture license. Kendrick Lim? Kendrick? No? Nope, okay, so this one we'll raffle it off again at a later point. I have a reminder about another raffle. If you're milling around, stop by to see Tim at Intersect Group and put your card in for the Amazon Echo raffle if you haven't. I'll remind you again before our next break. Okay, so we got that. All right. So next up on our program, I'm really pleased to have a group from ADP joining us. And so ADP, as I mentioned, is one of our platinum sponsors, and we really appreciate their support for today. It's a very large organization, and we've got support from several corners of it today. We got support coming out of we have a corporate headquartered UX team really based out of New Jersey, and Bon is over here, and she and I are both part of that team, and they provided support both in terms of time and also providing direct sponsorship. And also, we have a really great team that's just moved into an office in Pasadena several months ago. They're here today to present, and they also provided sponsorship as well, direct sponsorship and support for us. Many of you may have met Margot Deer. You may have met her at the meetup last week that featured Lou Rosenfeld over at that ADP office. I've asked Margot to kind of kick things off and say a few words about the ADP office and the team over there, and then she's going to introduce the panel, and away we go. Thank you.
Thanks, Weston. Also, big thank you again to Fandango for a great lunch. That was good, right? Yeah. And help yourself to the chocolates at the back. I think Tim has bought those as well. I've had a few. Weston asked me to say a few words about ADP, but I don't really know what to say, to be honest. We moved into the Pasadena area in the end of August last year. ADP as a company has been around forever, 60 years or something like that. But this is really new for our organization to be in the greater Los Angeles area and to be in Pasadena. It's pretty exciting for us. I would say in the past 8 months, we've been building a team of UX talent. We have about 350 people in the Pasadena office, mainly user experience, product management, and development or engineering. Our group focuses a lot on the tax compliance part of the payroll process. So this is the really sexy part of employee payment. I think some of the guys are probably going to be referencing some of this in their talks today, so you'll be able to see what we mean by that. What I'm going to do is, we've got three speakers. We've got Roel, who's a lead UX designer in our team, followed by Birchu, who is a senior researcher in the team, and then bringing up the rear is Eric, who's a UX manager / designer in our group. We're going to, similar to this morning's panel, we're going to do the QA at the end, so let's give a round of applause for Roel.
Fix this. Hello. It looks like they're doing the tech thing in the back. This fixed mic has thrown me off my game too. I was practicing with a Pez dispenser last night, moving around here. Good. Okay, cool. I'm not going to talk to you about information architecture through a project I worked on. I'm going to use an experience I just went through. I knew the bare minimum about taxes when I started working at ADP last September. The extent of my experience every year was tax forms would come to me in the mail. I'd collect them along with my receipts. I'd hand them to my tax lady, and I'd awkwardly stare at the back of her monitor as she moved her mouse around. And then a few weeks later, I'd get my tax return. I was hired to start designing products for tax professionals. So I knew I was going to have to learn about employment tax. And I knew, here it is, that it was going to be a steep learning curve. So I'm going to take you through what happened. So along with getting my computer, learning my new employee ID, finding out who the managers were, the vice presidents were, I was taught about amendments and how amendments are changes to taxes that had been filed. It involved a lot of numbers, so a tax professional or accountant can compare it to another spreadsheet of a lot of numbers and make sure everything was the same. There were acronyms to the labels of the numbers, like FIT, SIT, and SUI, and everyone was using those terms around me like I was already a tax expert. And then I was taught about agency notices, also called tracers. And they're physical letters sent to our clients from tax agencies through regular mail. Some agencies also send an agency notice to us in addition to our client, but not all agencies do it. Not even most, only some. And if an agency notice is sent to our client, they have to scan and email it or fax it to us, if faxes are still around in their office, so we know to take care of it. And then I was taught about periodics. A periodic is a payroll file that gets sent to us through one of our products called Transporter. It can be sent biweekly, weekly, daily, or whatever time period a payroll for a company repeats. It has totals of the payroll by jurisdiction, its balance against reports of the same information, just to make sure all the information matches up. You know, I hope you're confused or don't remember anything I just said, because I'm trying to make a point. And this is how it really happened. I reviewed my notebook to recreate the architecture of the information of my orientation to this subject matter. This same information kept getting repeated to me by product managers, designers, account managers, but because the architecture of the information being taught to me was like this, my knowledge was still here. And I think I'm a fairly intelligent person, but I'd go home every day exhausted from the mental gymnastics of trying to absorb this information. I was being taught again about amendments when I stopped paying attention to how it was being presented. I paused everyone in the meeting and I drew this on the whiteboard. Let me clean it up. So I took a step back view and I drew my chart. Periodics starts this link flow. Pay period salaries and wages from executives to part-timers that get sent to us. And then we calculate the taxes from there. If there's a mistake in that information, an agency notice is sent from the tax agency, like the IRS, to our client. And then to fix that mistake, we work with our client to submit an amendment. The product manager I was with said it was never illustrated like this before. There were really detailed charts that I was shown that had the nuances of each individual flow, and they had all the details and information. And each group was such an expert in their respective areas. The architecture always was like this, but it wasn't presented to me like this. So now with this digestible architecture, I was able to easier fill in the nuances, the inevitable nuances and layers of information. I started to understand the terminology. Each workflow was called a process. Each process can break down to phases, and each phase could break down to activities. Kind of hard to see, but. A lot of designers and writers smarter than me have shared their how-tos or tips on information architecture and creativity. Information architecture, as we know, has been around since the 70s, but I shared my story of onboarding at ADP as an example of two main points that helped me through the design process. The first you've heard many times before, you've heard it a lot today, and you'll continue to hear it throughout your careers. I think it's worth repeating because it's so important, but I'm also surprised how often it gets forgotten. Know your audience. I learned early on, product design one at Art Center, design isn't arbitrary. One of the things that let you stick to that is knowing your audience. It's not necessarily what they say, but what are their needs? What are their current behaviors? Having information about your target user helps so much when making design decisions. It prevents you from having to make decisions out of the blue. So going back to my orientation at ADP, I was talking to people who maybe forgot what it was like to not know about employment techs. They're great, they're really understanding and patient when it came to someone trying to learn this material, but there were still a lot of acronyms and terminology being thrown around me that made it even more difficult to understand. So don't lose sight of who you're designing for or who you're trying to speak to. The second point I'll share, I'll reinforce with a second story that I can't believe I'm willing to admit. But when I was a kid, my family would do a lot of road trips to Northern California to visit family, and we'd use Highway 5. And I was always looking forward to seeing cows, the cows. Yeah, there are cattle farms along the 5, but I'm talking about the cows that you see in this picture, faintly. So if you're having trouble seeing the cows, here's some help. So to me, these high voltage power lines always look like cartoon cows, shapes for their horns, ears, legs. So my second point is to know the appropriate time for, or know that balance of following standards, established patterns, following the rules, seeing power lines, versus following your own creative thinking, going with your gut, breaking the rules, seeing cows. Following standards and doing as you're told might not appeal to a creative person, but there are times when it's more appropriate because, for example, users just know a paradigm so well, or the payoff of a new design isn't worth the time and money saved developing what's already established. The wheel doesn't have to be reinvented every time. But there are also other times where you need to externalize your interpretation of all the research and design learning that you've absorbed in the design process. And you do reinvent the wheel. It's definitely more effort, and sometimes you'll have to try harder to sell your idea. So as I progress in my career, it's easier to figure out that fine line or gray area. Sometimes it's one, sometimes it's the other. You know when to pick your battles. So my name is Roel Punzalan, principal UX designer. I know employment tax, sort of, for the most part. So as you go through today and leave when it's done, take what everyone has said today, internalize it, but start breaking it down, make it your own. Follow the rules, break the rules. Thank you.
Today, I'm going to start my talk in a very unlikely place by sharing with you a little known fact about my pre-ADP life. I made a career in jerk studies. So since 2005, I've been doing research on jerks online. So what that means is that I've been doing ethnographic research and participant observation by becoming members of a bunch of notorious gaming groups online. What does that mean? Well, it means this. So in 2005, and I'm not sure if the lighting is going to allow you to see my avatars, In 2005, I was this. And then later, I started raiding with this character. And later, I started healing with this character. And later, I was this character. In fact, I'm still that character. And then later, I started flying this ship with a well-known, notorious gaming group in EVE Online called Goonfleet. Now, as a game researcher, I can tell you one thing. These things are not just games and fun. They have valid, equally real social, economic, and political orders. Okay? And my main takeaway from all this research was, and this is not something that people would tell you, is that it takes a lot of planning and strategizing to be a jerk online. Seriously. Yeah. So, I guess they don't just want to piss you off. They want to piss you off in the most innovative ways. And that takes a lot of effort. What I'm going to talk to you about is not just to do good research. You can read about that in a book. I want to talk to you about how to do good strategic research in a big corporation. And some of the key points that I'm going to tell you directly comes from the research that I've done previously. So, effective jerks online are really, really aware, they're keenly aware of the context in which their actions takes place. They're aware of the political atmosphere because they know that anything outside has the possibility to affect the quality of the pranks that they're doing, right? Their key leaders have a strong vision that are able to mobilize hundreds of players at the drop of a hat. They're also experts in identifying exploits and leveraging them to the maximum laughs, which is what they're going for. Now, it turns out that you can use these principles outside of the context of being just jerks. In fact, it turns out that these guys actually took these principles straight out of the book, The Art of War. Now, in this talk, I'm going to show you some of the ways in which you can apply these to UX research, right? And now, when I say this, I want to kind of, say that, you know, some of the principles are constant, but the way the execution of these principles may vary depending on the type of company we are working or the type of project. So I want to paraphrase that with that. So I joined ADP last year, okay? And I wasn't sure if I was going to quite align with the corporate culture, to be honest with you. I mean, from jerk studies to payroll systems is not a straight line. And yet it happened to me overnight, okay? And but as we were building the team, our new team, as I started interacting with my colleagues, I quickly realized that the people that I was working with were also not exactly quite aligned with the ADP culture. They were a little bit different. But then I realized that that was actually the point, right? We were hired not just to bring change in the software systems, but we were also hired to bring change in the ADP culture in general, right? So in a way, that too was kind of disruption, but not in the disruption that I was used to previously. It wasn't resulting in chaos, but it was resulting in positive change, okay? So, going back to ADP a little bit and our vision as the innovation center, I'm sure you recognize this slide. It shows the design thinking. At the innovation center, we would like to more align our UX efforts with design thinking. And just to paraphrase what design thinking is, for those of us who may be unaware, design thinking is a school of thought that upholds that all business problems could be approached with design thinking and design methodologies. And that's what we're trying to do here at ADP. And if you look at this chart, the first part, the first three honeycombs over there, looks at pre-discovery ethnographic work, whereas the latter part looks at more product building. You know, you built the prototype, you test it, you iterate, and you do it over and over again. That's the basis of agile development, okay? Now, thus far, we've been primarily focused on the latter part of it. Now, it's not that we haven't done any ethnographic research, it's just that our focus as UX research and development have been focusing on the latter part. So as a team, we're now planning on focusing on more of the primary part, the first part, so that we can build more mental modeling of the user culture. Now, as you can see, I'm not sure if it's clear from the light, is that research permeates every stage of this model, okay? And, but what I want to say today is that the job of the researcher even moves beyond this. Right? Especially if you're thinking about doing strategic research. And to make my point, I want to use a project that I've been working on for some time now as an example to showcase what I'm talking about. A line card. I don't know if you've heard of it, you're probably not. I'm going to tell you what it is. It's a payroll card. Now, payroll cards have been introduced in 2005. As a way to pay people without banks their social security benefits and tax benefits. So if you don't have a bank, you get this card and you get paid, right? The general demographic of this is people with low-income wages, the seasonal workers, temporary workers, and they're not banked. But we also at ADP knew that people who were banked and who were well-to-do were also using this product, but we just didn't know how, or we weren't really quite specific on their use habits. So the context came in for me twofold, in two steps. First, I wanted to understand what the product was being used for, the user habits. And the pre-discovery work that I did was actually with a survey. But I didn't want to limit my research for the Align card. I also wanted to understand what the competitors were doing in the space, right? So I sent out my survey to A, Align card users, B, payroll card users. And I contextualized, to get a wider scope of the field, I contextualized these results with external research done by third parties, but also with the results of the survey that was done by our partner. So the key takeaway from the survey was that the payroll card users, the power user of payroll card users, was the millennials and the affluent well-to-do demographic, which is something that we hadn't really focused on until now. And then I ran a series of interviews with one-on-one interviews, which confirmed this assumption. I did affinity mapping, captured user voices, and captured use habits of each of these demographic. But the context also included other actors. So far, I've been focusing on the employee end of things, but there was another actor in the space, and that was a payroll specialist. Now, payroll specialist is a person who enrolls the employee, right? Who reissues the card when the employee loses his card, who cancels the card when the employee quits the job, right? We haven't really accounted for this person. More importantly, Align Card was one of the product in the entire wage payment ecosystem. That was the larger context. Now, what do you gain from looking at this larger context, especially in a big corporation? Well, whatever happens in other products outside of Roron, whatever decisions that they're making, influences in unforeseeable ways your product. That's what you become aware of. And the other thing is that as a researcher, you are aware of the problems and the challenges of different types of products. And so moving forward, you can design research that would address similar problems that are coming up in different research projects. So you can kind of cut corners. But you also, for us, there was also one more concern. This was the concern that triggered this research. We had 5 UX resources, 5 out of 9 UX resources dedicated to wage payment. That was a lot of resources. So we needed to come up with a UX strategy. We need to figure out what the gaps in our research was and what the priority for our research was going to be. So what I did was I mapped out all of our products in the wage payment area. We had 2 apps, 1 API that we use in the restaurant business to tip waitresses. We had a payroll administrator site that administrators used, and we had an employee site that the employees used. Those were our products. Then I talked to stakeholders. I asked them about their visions of their product. I asked them about their challenges. I asked them about their success metrics. Now, I gotta say, when you ask these questions like that, the answers you're getting are usually at first very vague, so you have to really push hard. Then I captured all of this information, and I put it there, right? In different sticky notes. I also plugged in the research that we have done thus far and the research that we were about to do and the research we hadn't even thought about. So when you laid out everything in different colors and mapped it out like this, it became quite clear what the gaps were in the research and what the priorities were supposed to be. Now the outcome of it is you gain a deeper understanding of wherever your research is situated. More importantly, what you realize is, especially in a large corporation, the product owners, the product managers work in silos, and sometimes they're really not aware of what's going on in next door. So it's up to you as a researcher to connect the dots and present the context. So being a strategic researcher requires a lot of stakeholder management and goodwill. The other thing is understanding the overall vision, because the overall vision will inform your research goals or your research decisions. The problem here, again, is that stakeholders, well, the vision is so fragmented when you speak to stakeholders separately. And sometimes the vision does not get articulated crystal clear enough, like it's not really clear. And that's the case, you as the researcher are asked to step in and do some of these things. And sometimes it helps to bring all the stakeholders under one roof in one group and do workshops. We've been doing, for different products, some effortless customer experience workshops where we bring all the stakeholders, do journey mapping. We look into impact on business. We do short-term goals, long-term goals, and we come up with a strategy. So after the wage payment one, I want to show you some of these slides, which I'm not sure if you can see it. After the wage payment workshop that we had, I made a mental model. I did a mapping of the 3-day workshop. Now, it became clear to us at the workshop that the key actor in this model was the payroll specialist, the payroll administrator, because the payroll administrator was training the regional managers, who in turn trained all the employees. So if the payroll specialist had 5 problems, that 5 problems snowballed into 10 problems at the manager level, which then snowballed into 20 problems or 15 problems at the employee level. So we figured if we can fix the problems of the payroll manager as best as we can, we could come across or we can get ahead of some of the problems that might arise in the future. Okay? So that's where the leverage came in. So I went back into my map again and identified 2 leverage points right here. One was administrative site. If we made the administrative site very easy and it didn't require a lot of training on the payroll specialist part, which was one of the pain points of the payroll, then we were short-circuiting or sidestepping a lot of the problems that arise with the payroll. And then the other thing in my map that I saw was to improving self-service products. the products where employees can themselves use instead of relying on the payroll administrator. So if we were to improve some of the employee-facing products, that they could do some of the work that the payroll administrator was doing themselves. So when I simplified the chart to this, it became clear where the research priorities were going to lie and how we should allocate or reallocate our design sources. Thank you.
Hi, folks. I'm going to interrupt here for a little bit, and I'm going to apologize about the light thing. We're going to do a little rotation exercise, okay? It's going to be fun for everyone. We're going to rotate the projector. You all have to find some way to kind of rotate around. So you can. We're going to aim to the north wall. Sorry about the previous slides, folks. I think what we'll... I would like to try to gather as many of the presentation decks as possible, and I'll make them available online after. North wall, the big with the big empty space in it. That's fine. I'm going to do a couple giveaways. We're also going to take care of a couple raffle things during this time. Rebecca, if you can hear me, I do need one name from you for a raffle item, please. To take away chairs from there? I think it's okay. Okay, so we're going to take care of a couple raffle items right now. We have Tim Sisson from the Intersect Group who's going to do the drawing for the Amazon Echo. And while he's coming up, Rebecca, if you can hear me in back, we do need one name for a drawing. I have one item that we still didn't give away successfully. So when we have a chance for that. So Tim, you want to...
We got a bag here. We should probably get a volunteer, right?
Yeah. A volunteer to pull a card out?
And make it easy.
Roel or Oh, if you win, it's still okay if you win. It's okay.
Disney. Priyanka? Am I reading that correctly?
Priyanka, you win the Amazon Echo from Intersect Group. Are you still here? Yeah. Oh, awesome. Yay. Thank you. Okay, and we also have the additional Acture license that we still need to give away, and this is going to Joanna DeJarnett, if you're here. Great, all right, cool. Thank you. This should be- All right, so I guess there is like a question in my head right now, which is, Eric, do you mind being standing on the side of the audience? Okay. Is there a better option? I could give you the clicker, and you can take the mic.
Yeah,
All right, I need to get my remote clicker thing.
So how's this for agile? Whichever microphone will work best for me.
I didn't do that.
I'm sorry? I wanted my speaker notes, but I guess we'll just fly without them. See how this goes.
Can I move the laptop over that way a little? No. Okay.
Yeah, notice now the sun has started playing nicely with us, but that's okay. So it's been a day of kind of high and lows, right? Like I was really, really excited that there were vegan options for people like me, which is kind of awesome. And I'm also really bummed about the position of the sun in the universe right now. So it's the back button to go forward. And this is an IA conference. All right, so that was probably loud. My name is Eric Hansen. This is going to be a presentation about innovation, which I know makes probably some of you crawl in your skin a little bit, but hopefully by the end of it, it won't be too bad. So a little about me. Again, my name is Eric Hansen. I'm a UX designer and manager at ADP in the Innovation Center in Pasadena. When I'm not sitting at my desk doing weird design stuff, I'm a dad. I ride mountain bikes and race them, and I'm kind of a nerd, which you might see through some of this. So, continuing on a little bit about me, I've worked at a number of companies, some big, some small, and I think that I can rightfully say that all of them have been innovative in their own right. They've all done some really interesting and innovative things. But for today's talk, in specific, I think we'll focus on the enterprise. And this is where I could really use my presenter notes for my transition. But so when we talk about innovation, and I go back to that kind of skin crawling thing, it's a word that you really have to kind of be careful with, right? It's a word that has a number of different meanings to a number of different people, and honestly, it's a word with a lot of baggage. Another one of those words is creativity, I think, but that's for another talk. So when you say innovation to some people, what they might conjure up is this image of someone like Tony Stark doing the plausible impossible and 3D screens floating in the air, which, you know, from this morning's talks, maybe that's going to happen sooner than I think. But I think for the purpose of today and for the purpose of some of what we're going to talk about, what I want to do is maybe redefine innovation and kind of ground us a little bit in something that we can work with and actually talk about. So here's a quote from Steve Jobs about innovation. And obviously you can read the whole thing, but I kind of want to focus on the highlighted part. And if I remember correctly, it's something about the people that you've got, whether or not they get it, and how they're led. Not in exactly that order, but that was close enough. So to me, what that means is that innovation really isn't about things floating in the air or products, but it can also be about teams and communication and process and methods. And I think we've touched on that a little bit this morning about maybe how some of these processes and methods are changing. So it's not just about iPhones and gadgets, but it's about people too. So again, I like frameworks, so we can talk about what is and what isn't innovation. I want to talk a little bit about a concept of a local maximum. So if you think about a product you have right now, or a screen, or a device, you can probably think of ways to make it a little better, and that would be kind of moving towards iterative optimizing piece of making it a little bit better. But one of the problems when you do that and you get kind of focused on that is you forget to lift your head up and look for what the next better design or larger peak or bigger opportunity might be. So again, local maximum is kind of that iterative piece, and then innovation for at least this talk I'm going to define as finding or looking past that next bigger piece. So as an example of optimization versus innovation, there's the story of the 41 shades of blue with Google, where the designer was working on a search results page. He picked a specific shade of blue. Engineers didn't really like that. So they decided to test 41 different shades. So here lies the world of optimization. Maybe they found a slightly better shade of blue, and one that converted when you've got as many things going on as Google, 0.0065% is meaningful. But maybe there was some other larger opportunity that they could have found that they missed by cycling through that optimization. So that really talks about making the design right, and I think you can make any design more right, or making the right design. So again, that contrast between optimization and innovation. I think the transportation industry is an interesting model to look at for both periods of optimization and innovation. So this is a Model T, give or take a year. So back in 1908, Model T was released. And I think today we kind of re-remember history as the Model T was the innovation of the day. And the thing that we forget is that automobiles had been around for decades at this point. And the real innovation that happened here that Henry Ford did was the assembly line. And it was the assembly line that allowed the automobile to finally become a common man's tool and finally really radicalized the transportation industry at the time. So if we fast forward 108 or 109 years into the future, this doesn't look all that different. I mean, it's more comfortable, probably a little faster. Air conditioning, always nice, a little safer. We've got Bluetooth, we've got Google Maps, so it's definitely better. But is it really an innovation? Because this doesn't feel innovative to me at all, and I suffer through this every day. So if that truck is a symbol of optimization or a symbol of optimization, then what is that next bigger peak, right? So we've got that local maximum, and maybe we're somewhere around in the transportation industry of that local maximum. What is that next better opportunity? And maybe it's driverless cars, utilizing information systems, computers, all that fun stuff that we like to play with. Maybe that is the next wave of transportation. And you've got companies like Google trying to tackle this and be really innovative in this space. And it's interesting because when you've got these kinds of problems and these big things, what you run into a lot is risk, right? So some companies may actively avoid innovation because it's risky. And then you get a culture of fast following, and that's not much fun to be a part of. So if we take this metric of risk versus reward, and we start to think about the types of companies that can really dig into that risk and get that bigger reward. And it's interesting because I also think that within those risky problems is probably where a lot of the best design work is. So again, thinking about what companies can handle that, I think today's leadership in larger companies, or back to that enterprise piece, are really motivated to take on those risks because there are other pressures on those companies, consumerization, disruption from smaller companies, to finally start to leverage the capital that they've had after being around for 60 years or a lifetime, like ADP, to go through and take on some of those risks. A question that I often get at this point is like, really, enterprise? Like, that kind of sucks, except for the TV show. And in my experience, when it comes to innovation, when it comes to companies, unless you're sitting at the table with that founder and you're drawing on the napkin with him, you're really past the innovation stage. They're at a point where they've got to get more capital. They've got to get to their IPO. They've got to get what they've got just generating the economic engine enough that the innovation starts to fall to the side, and it's really just about production again. So the first part of this that I want you to kind of leave away with is that within the right companies and within the right spaces, and maybe this is a unique time, that the enterprise really is one of the right spaces to be, to do some of the best work and really kind of go boldly where no one has gone before. And maybe, if we're lucky, we can take something like this, and it's a laser pointer too, and turn it into something like this, or because, if you're me, maybe something more like that with bikes everywhere, because that's kind of awesome. So hopefully at this point, you're going, hooray, innovation, and not like skin crawling innovation. But what does that really have to do with UX professionals and what we're trying to do? And I think that it gets into some of the conversations we had this morning about how roles are changing for UX, whether you're a researcher, whether you're an information architect, or a designer. Back in the day, we might sit around and produce artifacts a lot like this, and it was really just kind of about producing these things and getting them out there in a certain way, and hopefully they took hold or people understood them. And now it's really much more about not only doing that, but then carrying that ball down the field the rest of the way and really telling the story of how those impact what you're trying to do. And you're in a position where you really have to develop this culture of collaboration and moving things forward through innovation and be the voice of that customer through it. So there's a lot more salesmen and there's a lot more pitching going on and convincing. So what I think UX ends up really doing is kind of gathering everyone around and being the person that can go across the cross-functional teams and sell that vision and drive that innovation. You really are the voice around the campfire, kind of bringing everyone together and telling the story. I mean, really, it's what we do. We're about people and we're about stories. So that's really what our job is turning into. We've already got the skills for this. I think as UX practitioners, we empathize with our clients, we empathize with our customers, sometimes we even empathize with product owners on really interesting days. We can communicate the visions that we have to the different teams, from developers to business. We can prototype those ideas. We've got the skills for that, and then we can research and help drive those things forward. So we're in a singular and unique position to bring these across. Everything. So the question you might be asking yourself is, what the hell does this have to do with information architecture at all? So what I want to do is tell a story that should help bring all of what I've talked about so far together, and it's utilizing ADP and some of the things that we've done. This will probably look familiar because it's one of the things that we do, right? This is the way marketing sells our product. It's this beautiful, holistic piece of wonderfulness that's going to make your life so much easier. But we realize that this is probably the way that it's really being built. You've got a number of different teams that sit in their silos, work on their goals, and try to get stuff done. And that ends up really kind of building an experience that feels and looks a lot more like this. Not a whole lot of fun. And this is what we were trying to combat about 24 months ago with some of the work that we were doing. So we were working on a design for one of our products, and we built some prototypes, and we kind of got them out there, and we did some executive presentations, and everybody was pretty happy about it. And we felt pretty good about ourselves, because, you know, why not? But I don't know if we really took the opportunity at that time in the beginning to get everyone around the campfire and get everyone on the same page. So after some of what we had designed and talked about fell flat with the development teams and things were being built that really didn't adhere to what we were trying to do and the vision that we had, we needed to drop back and take all of the things that we had produced, all of those artifacts that we had worked on, and really start to bring people together with those. So this was an expression of a taxonomy that we did moving forward through some of our designs. And this was kind of one of the first things that we put out, and really not a whole lot of traction. So what we figured out, and actually Weston deserves some of the credit for this through here, was we got all the teams together and basically talked them into getting in the same room for a couple hours and knocking all this stuff out and really kind of guiding them through the journey of that taxonomy and the journey of that controlled vocabulary and getting everyone kind of literally on the same page. So we went through and took their processes as they exist, and we worked through getting those onto the new taxonomy and onto the new framework with each of them. They could go and see what the other teams had put down and how the other teams were utilizing this stuff. We took the interface and actually laid the taxonomy on top of it so they could see how that drove what we were trying to do and the commonality between the things. We provided them kind of an empty state of that sheet that I showed earlier that allowed them to fill that out. We could workshop that with them. They could take it back to what they were doing. And again, what UX was able to do at that point was really kind of take the wheel of what was going on, not be subjected to, but help move forward with the development cycle and the teams. So UX, again, was that tool to get everyone together, leveraging the IA, this is what I was going to tie that in sooner or later, to really create that experience that we wanted for our customer. Would have been nice to have water, too, podium, I tell you. So I think what we learned from this is that innovation really requires not only articulation, but collaboration, and there's another shun word that I forgot that would have been in my presenter notes. But it's really just about getting everyone together and not just handing things out, but being that voice and being the shepherd of the different teams to get to that vision. This is a quote that I feel narcissistic right now. Where instead of trying to put something out to change the way a product is, it's really more about changing how people are thinking about, that's very kind, thank you. Thank you. I am actually gonna do this, so bear with me. So it's not about changing a legacy product in as much as it's about changing legacy thought. Because if you can change the way that people are thinking and working together, you can change what they're building. And that's when you can really start to drive down into building culture and changing the way an organization, even a larger enterprise organization, works and be that voice. And I almost pressed the forward button. So it really is up to us, I believe, as I'm saying now, that we have to do the work. We have to be the ones that bring people together. And I think that if we can do that through narrative and through story and through an articulate and collaborative voice, we really can be the ones that help make our dent and change the world. And that's my UXIA kind of pitch into that. So thank you. So we're still gonna, all right, so we're gonna do questions, and I was told that I was to mention that you should use the microphones when asking questions, because it's like, they're fun, you know. I got to carry it around for a while.
I'm gonna steal this one for a second and say, thank you for being patient with us in the sunshine, which you can see moved on. Probably it moved on while I was doing the raffle things and I didn't realize it. We don't really need to see the projection right now, so we're gonna go ahead and we're gonna rotate it back while we do Q&A up here, but that means you all get to do your little dance again, so try to remember your questions for Roel and Virtue and Eric. Please don't turn your chair around to face the back, okay? That would be rude. Okay, questions from the audience? Please use the microphones, please. It's really helpful for folks. We actually have folks watching the live stream, and they want to hear your questions from you. Thank you.
Awesome. Hey, guys. I guess this question's kind of directed towards Eric, because we just talked about this. But great talk. I've worked at some enterprise companies and financial companies, and part of the problems that they have is that they're, like you were talking about, the thinking, legacy thinking. There's some really old dinosaurs at those companies that don't understand the design process. They're kind of stuck in the old ways of thinking. They know that they need to innovate, and there's other smaller companies and startups that are eating away at their revenues. And their solution to all that is to have an innovation lab. Okay? And their solution is that's going to fix everything. Yeah. So what do you say about that? You know, I think other people have talked about design as a team sport. But you've been talking about culture, and that's kind of design as a company sport. Can you talk about that? Is it better to have a change at the company level, innovation groups? What works for producing change?
Oh, boy. Good question. We are in an innovation lab.
Center.
Taxonomy. So how to package this up? I think that, and I think we can use ADP as evidence to some of this, is that if the company is to a point that they are they're walking that part of the talk, that they're willing to invest that much into it, that you've got buy-in at a level, right? And it may not be the level where you feel it every day in the work that you're doing, it may not even feel like it for the past 6 months, right? Like they've made this investment, they're talking all this stuff, you're looking at the marketing on the wall, and you're kind of like, that's not what we're doing. And I think that the way that I've had to look at this is that if you've got that environment to be in and you're not seeing any sparks, that maybe you're the spark that needs to drive that forward and can ignite other people around you. Because the company's obviously invested in it and they want to do it, but maybe they just don't know how. So one of the things I think about my personality that ends up working is that I don't know if Virtue was researching me, but sometimes I can be kind of a jerk, right? Like I can be fairly forceful. I can be vocal. And I think you have to do that. You have to do it from the right perspective, and you have to do it from the right space in your heart to move these things forward. You can't just be complaining about the work that you have to do. And I think that's at least how I tackle it. I don't know if that helps your situation, but.
That's very good. I think that design has come a long way. Back in the day, people still complain about this, but some people talk about how design doesn't get a seat at the table. And now people are starting to understand design a little bit more, UX and what we do. So perhaps this is a step in the right direction, these innovation labs and groups. But I agree. I think, challenging some of these legacy thinkers and being more vocal, it's an art. It is an art.
And it's interesting that you said seat at the table, because I think over the past few years, UX definitely has gotten a seat at the table. But I would say that a lot of us don't know what to do with that seat yet. Mm. And we have to figure that out. And that's part of being, I think, that voice to help move things forward.
Awesome. Thank you.
Wonderful presentation, thank you. I'm actually in the same position as the previous gentleman. I work for a huge enterprise, and they're kind of trying to figure out where to stick the UX. Are you a creative designer? Are you a developer? So it looks like ADP, leadership at ADP kind of had a vision, and they gave you sort of like being a shepherd, like you mentioned, of multiple teams. Have you dealt with any pushback from those legacy teams, it's like, oh, who are you? Like, I've been doing this for years and I've been designing this way. Like, who are you to tell me, what to do? Like, who are you, period? And how did you deal with this?
So, good question. And I'm gonna answer my part of it, and then I'm gonna see if anyone else wants to grab onto it too. The way that I think that we do that is prove what we're saying is the right direction by validating with our customers and ensuring that through the testing and through the research that we're providing value that surpasses what people thought we could give them to begin with. So in those legacy systems and how people are trying to basically say, what the hell are you doing here? We've done it this way forever. If we can show that the new way is both qualitatively and quantitatively better, then it's hard for them to stand on much.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say, is gather as much background information as you can. That's your arsenal for your side of the argument. And at the same time, turn that into something that shows them that it's beneficial. It's not about what you say. It's everything you output.
I just worked here for almost a year, and it's been really amazing to see how much the research has been starting to value at ADP. We just had this meeting this weekend, and all they wanted, the senior product owner, the senior product manager, all he wanted to do is hear about the research, where we had kind of weeded out the research because we thought he would wanted to see the product. So I think that right now, I can't speak of overall cultural change, but I know that, before the center, when we were in San Dimas, that this was a long and hard battle that the previous UX people had to fight. But right now it's kind of, you know, for me, it's almost really good to see that research has been really valued, UX has been really valued. Now, I don't know where we're going to end up in. Like you were saying, like a lot of companies open up these innovation labs and centers and then they don't have the change that they hope to have. I can't speak what the end of our story will be, but right now I think we're at the sweet spot. That's where I would add.
The voice of the customer is super powerful. And we, in the Lou Rosenfeld talk, I think he even mentioned that UX can't stand up and say that we're fighting for the customer anymore. And I would disagree with part of that, because if the executives and the people that matter aren't hearing the voice of the customer, then we really do have to fight for that and get that in front of them. So we got a question back here. I think there's a microphone. Just there you go.
There's been a lot of reference today about the importance of narrative and storytelling, and I'm wondering how, in your guys' experience, you've incorporated or found ways to bring the narrative to the forefront in your projects.
So every project's really a project within a project, right? It's not about just designing the product that you want to output. It's about also designing how to build that. What are the artifacts? What are the communication methods? How do you speak to development? That's a project within itself. Like I said, follow the rules and break the rules. We had certain documentation methods when I started at ADP, but then part of the problem was figuring out what new ways can we use to talk to development, can we use to tell the story to management, to the executives. Another part of the problem there is sometimes you put that story together, but you're not the one that gets to tell the story. Sometimes someone takes what you put together and presents it to executives. So you have to make sure it's clear, not just if you're gonna say it, but if someone's gonna tell the story for you.
I'm not sure if it was clear from my slides, so I'm just gonna kind of hope that the research that I did, the interview analysis and the report that I presented at the end for the Align card, I actually told the report around the two different personas that we had come up with. Well, the first one, like I said, the initial demographic was, you know, low income, underbanked, underbanked meaning not banked, and the other one was more affluent and banked. So the way that I presented the story, readout was I kind of used those personas to made it their stories and made it sound like it's a day in their lives and how they're using the Align card and what were the challenges that they had and what were the recommendations that I would give. So in that respect, you can use some of the personas to build up your stories when you're presenting the readouts to the product managers.
And just to reference back to that whole innovation thing, it's not just about the product, but it's how, like, you're not iterating just through designs. You should be iterating through your processes and methods to try to get those designs moving forward. So being playful with how you're telling the story and trying to find new ways and figuring out what works. I'm getting the one more kind of signal here. At least it was this one and not
someone else. Hi, I think this question is more for you. If you're in a company that recently started a UX department and want to do a lot more UX research, what would you recommend as the core capabilities or initial hires that you would do in order to create something like that?
Are you speaking of just UX research, or is this a big company? Because if it's a startup, there's only going to be like, they're not going to hire UX much if this is a startup. I mean, probably Margo has more experience because she built this team right now, but You know, if it's a, if it has a, it's a big company with well-to-do kind of funding, researchers are generally the last one to hire in a UX team. Because right now, when you look at even the job applications, the job openings you see, there's always this desire, well, we want a UX designer, but they also list research that they want to do, right? So right now, when I showed you the design thinking slide, and I said that we want to more focus on the first end, the ethnographic, we want to pull our researchers to do the ethnographic, but we also want to train our designers to do the more usability testing and whatever. So when the companies, when they start the UX team, they initially are looking for designers who can do more of the usability testing, but also gather a little bit more, you know, people who can just do the, you know, pre-discovery work, but not in depth, right? When a company is starting the UX team right off the bat, they're not going to invest in hardcore researchers like us. That thing goes more to the designers. And I don't know, that's my sense of it just by looking at the job market, but maybe you guys can add.
Yeah, this is something I learned now working with Margot, something that gets overlooked. You're gonna find skills with a lot of people. Like, everyone's gonna reach a certain level. But with Margot and putting this team together and the fact that we have this like really great chemistry and we became friends right away, that's something that probably gets overlooked. There's this chemistry. You kind of wanna look for a certain charisma because that helps with trying to motivate other people to do what you want them to do.
It helps with the vision. The vision is very important. Here, actually, the vision is very, very important, I might add.
Thanks very much.
Thank you, everyone. Appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Bertu, Roel, and Eric, and Margot. Thank you all for bearing with us also in terms of the little the logistics we went through. All right. I'm going to stall for a moment. actually, what I am going to do is I'm going to, let's see. Well, let me ask. Mike, do you want me to keep this plugged in? Okay. Okay, cool. All right. So what I think we can do, they need to check some things on the projector. I'm going to say a few words about our upcoming presenters, and maybe you want to go ahead and plug in. You can. I'll move my laptop out of the way. We can get you plugged in here while I talk about you. Can you catch that for me? Thank you. Is this
50%
on?
Battery, that should be.
All right, so I don't have a lot prepared to say about our speakers because they kind of speak for themselves. Up next we have Jod Kaftan and Chris Chandler, and I know they're very well known in the community here, and I think it's accurate to say that Jod is the first speaker I lined up for this event. I knew I wanted to have a day full of really thoughtful, smart, interesting people who I would want to hear from all day long. And Jod was one of the first people I reached out to, and I was really tickled when he agreed and he said this would sound like a fun opportunity. And then I got even more tickled when a certain person who arrived rather late today. Oh, this could be fun.
I just want to make sure my presenter knows. It's always the...
We spoke, and we decided that it might be a good idea to add him to our program.
Sometimes
should I tell the whole story?
Until you're...
The whole painful story?
Is it that painful?
Right, no.
Let's see, view.
It's a
very
great story.
It's a really great story. And Chris has recently moved over to Philosophy. An agency that I'm not real familiar with myself, but I'm going to learn more about it soon.
took it off, right?
And Chris brought us sponsorship from Philosophy, which is awesome. And then I think he used that as leverage with me. I'm not quite sure how this works, but somehow, the next thing I knew, Chris was on the speaker lineup too. And thanks to the good graces of Jod, where I kind of shoehorned him in, and I said, Jod, Chris is interested. Would you be interested in partnering with them? Because I'm out of slots. So we partnered together. I won't mention the part about where I had to change the whole schedule for you. I'll leave that out. And then you came late enough that you almost missed that anyway? No, that's good. Are we ready? Should I stop insulting Chris? Or?
Chris is high maintenance, by the way.
This better be really good now after the, after this. Okay. Mm-hmm. Did we have any other kind of an oh, I know what I forgot to announce. And it, we haven't yet gone to the break, but you can think about it, you know, kind of let it mull around the back of your mind. So after Chris and Jod, we're going to have a break. We have some sign-up sheets. I think they're on the back side of the gigantic doors, the super gigantic doors on the back side over there. There's some sign-up sheets for, like, after party, have a drink, have dinner with some folks. Because what you're going to find out at the end of this presentation, after the end of the show today, is I'm going to kick you out immediately because we need to tear down and vacate. So you all have to get out, make groups, and go have dinner and have drinks. We've got a list of some local places. We got some sign-up sheets out there. Maybe you can sign up. Or if one of you feels, you know, really enterprising, go to a sheet, put your name on it, and say you're going to be the leader of that after party, and then people will want to join with you. You could do that. Feel free to, you know, adopt an after party. We do not have to clear the parking lot immediately. I believe the parking lots will stay open until the wee hours. And I have been told if your car gets locked in somehow, there's a security desk that will be here and they can let you in. But we don't have to, you can leave your car and go have dinner and drinks and come get it later. With that, I will turn the stage over to Jod and Chris. Thank you.
Wow, this is a lot of people. I was not expecting that, but... first thing I'd love to do is just, and this might sound a little corny, but it'll give me time to make sure that my deck is the right version, which is to introduce yourself to your partner next to you, and I would like you to very quickly say one thing about the future that you hope, that you can imagine changing for the better. Just do it right now, real quick. I don't have to talk. It's great. Okay. Shut it down. No, that's the whole point. There's a lot to talk about, isn't there? Right? Where do we begin? So I did have the pleasure, he's not totally high maintenance, of collaborating with Chris on this. We have two parts to our presentation. Yes. And I will say this as an aside. All I did was go on to the Noun Project and I searched geek and I found two people that looked exactly like us. It's pretty incredible, I have to say. The other thing I would say, I saw a lot of Star Trek references, so I want to just get the elephant out of the room, which is that my mom actually was Spock's bride on the original show, which makes me part Vulcan. And so I am actually not totally human, which means this presentation is gonna be a little bit weird, and that's good. I'm also actually in between jobs, because I will be starting at this place. Looks like I'm running for Congress, but I am actually working at Fjord in a few days. So I speak as an independent agent of the human world. But as a pro-Fjord cheerleader. Great. So let's talk a little bit about, let's go into part one, which is my part. Good. We will start with the Big Bang. And I've actually recreated it for you. Wait, I am not actually seeing my notes. Hold on. There they go. You need notes on the Big Bang slide, let me tell you. Now, the Big Bang, we will creep up to the edge of our comfort zone of religiosity in this, and I don't mean to, because I mean this to be absolutely non-religious as possible. But that being said, the Big Bang, we look at it as that moment in which some force said life should exist. And life is not just human beings, but the activation of the evolutionary process, right? You didn't think you were going to get into this, did you? And there are essentially three responses to this event that we can have that we may not even realize that we have a point of view on. One is that, come on, advance. Hold on, sorry. Oh, that was even worse. Let's try that again. I'll just tell you. There you go, thank you. One is that you can have a big no. This was a big no. This whole thing, it was a bad idea. That doesn't mean if you have a big no point of view that you're not doing good in this world, right? It just means that it was bad. You can also have a big shrug. It happened. Nothing we can do about it. And finally, you can have a big yes. So let's talk a little bit about the big no, big shrug, and big yes. The big no has its philosophical school, mostly pessimism, I suppose, might be one way of framing it. The philosopher Oswald Spengler basically wrote a book called Decline of the West, which is essentially that we are in a retrograde. That civilization, almost if you think of it as from the fall of Eden, is never going to recover. It's just irreversible. It's getting bad. It's going to get worse. What I ask, and part of this exercise, is to get, Chris and I don't have we're not proselytizing. We're asking humbly for you to think with us about this. What does this mean? If you're thinking it or not, if this is something you identify with, what does this mean to you and your relationship to life and your relationship to design work and the solutions that you come up with? How would this impact how you work on projects? I don't care if you're working on a lead gen page for Fitbit. How does this relate to it? The next, in the big shrug, coming from Aristotle, basically that life is a cyclical, the universe is cyclical, it will go through ebbs and flows. Another way that might impact you is that this whole thing is neutral and meaningless. And we're here, let's just make the best of it, right? But what does that mean to your relationship, to your job, to your family, to your work? And finally, Sir Francis Bacon, who really approached the future as a progressive and upward ascent. That doesn't happen through deterministic forces, that we have to engineer that. And I'm not going to turn this into an academic lecture, but basically using inductive thinking rather than deductive, inductive meaning building experiments sequentially and then arriving at some sort of law or axiom that is true. That just took the sexiness out of the idea, which is if this Big Bang, if life is exactly a good thing, that is something that should exist, what does that mean to your work, to your relationship, to the people that you relate to in your work, specifically into design? And the reason that we go off on this rather big tangent is in my own work, I had, this is sort of my own testimonial, you know, I had previously been in an organization that I just left, 100 years, in which we focused on positive impact types of engagements. And so I got on a project, and you know, we're all, as responsible UX designers, we get on a project, and first thing we want to know is what's the business goal? And a lot of times the business goal is we need to increase registrations, we need you know, customer acquisition, blah, 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 blah. And I got on a project, and the goal was to make healthcare a right and not a privilege in America. And I was like, whoa, okay, well, let me look for a case study on that. Right. So I was excited by that. But I really struggled as I am, my DNA is kind of like part idealist, part hardcore pragmatist, borderline cynicist at times. And it bothered me that this goal was so soft, you know? As a UX, my UX brain was kicking in. I was like, why is this so soft? What do you mean? How are we gonna measure this, right? And I sat with it. And it bothered me that I didn't have mastery over the future, that my team couldn't have mastery over this. So I realized, what was my resistance against this project? What was that really about? And what it was, what I came up with was that I really realized that I was a big no person. And it kind of shocked me, because here I was working at some positive impact place, and I didn't believe, I had no faith in humanity. Well, great, maybe I should, you know, work somewhere else. But the important thing was that resistance was really an important thing to meditate on for a moment. And even though I believed in the principle that every healthcare should be a right, that people should be healthy, I worried that if everyone was healthy, we'd have population growth problems, and I have no faith in our government, and I have no faith in helping those people feed themselves and have good lives and living together. And so I looked at the work that we were doing, and the work we were doing kind of emerged from this kind of big no, big shrug hybrid sensibility deep within myself. And then when I started to reflect, like, okay, well, what if the future is going to be better? Let's just do an experiment in optimism, Jod. Just try it for a second. I found that a whole set of different creative solutions in my design work started to present themselves. I'm not going to go in and, you know, show you every whiteboard, but I could say that when I was in the big no, big shrug stage, we were creating a platform for Robert Wood Johnson Foundation that was essentially, you know, a conversation platform around the future of health. But it was like the user's role in it was kind of like making comments, opinions, blah, blah, blah. And then when I moved into my big yes framework, I was able to really listen to the client, and the client was actually saying, hey, we have no effing clue how to get there. We just want to start the conversation. We want people to fulfill this vision with us. And then that clicked into the platform becoming more about people submitting their visions of what that looks like. And I don't think we would have arrived at that creative solution if we hadn't become more of big yes people. Because if we don't believe that something is possible, it can't exist. Which then, you know, it's funny, and you start to change your outlook, you start to attract stuff to you. And you know, I think this quote really does encapsulate that if you think things are getting worse, you grab everything you can, you live for the moment, not in the best way, for what you can get from it, how does it relate to me, rather than investing in a better future. So we've talked about the Big Bang, and now I'm going to talk about another word, moral, which for those of us with fine arts degrees that probably grew up in the 310 part of Los Angeles, it's a little bit of a scary word. It's synonymous with people telling you what to do. But this notion of a vision is always talked about, and I think it's talked about quite eloquently in the previous presentation. For me, I wanted to push that even further, because look, Napoleon had a vision of conquering Russia. You know, what is a moral imagination? And so for me, the word moral, as we will define it today, is really grounded in empathy. We are talk about empathy as a part of our work, right? We know that's our secret UX sauce that we bring to the table. But now it's been adopted, it's talked about, it's very, very rarely actually do you get to do it. But what I would like to do, to suggest, is that we take it up a notch, that it's actually, that empathy is involved in imagining what it might be like to feel that person or that culture, and how what it might feel like for people to relate to each other in that way. To tie it all the way back, what might it feel like for people to have healthcare as a right and not a privilege? That's moral imagination, more than just a vision. And for people that are, you know, I'm always at war with I have a sort of lean sensibility that I believe in design, that design comes from emerging truths, but that it also comes from realizing preferred futures. And if you think of it just pure science, you know, Galileo used his imagination to make certain conclusions. The physicist William Harvey knew that blood circulated. He just knew it. There was nothing scientific about it. And then he went out and to prove it. So this notion of imagination and vision and what should exist is prevalent, even just in the strict scientific world. So our responsibility is not simply to just make things. And there is a whole school of design thinking that says design is about giving form to things, right? And it is. But it's equally about realizing these preferred futures. And so if we look at, and here's some basic beats of kind of iterative design or lean and agile, start with your business outcome, create assumptions, define the problem. Well, these are all things I still very much believe in. I think they're honest. But if you look at a lot of the iterative work today, you see that you have people saying, well, we don't really know what we want. You know, man, I mean, we're just gonna do like an MVP and then we'll see what it is, you know? We'll see, maybe it'll be a horse, maybe it'll be a pizza, you know? And what they're missing, what's being misinterpreted there is the vision, the certainty of who you want to be, but a doubt, a healthy set of doubts about how you're gonna get there. And even that certainty, right, can have some flux to it, but it still has to be a certainty. And so what we propose, if we deduce from the moral imagination into a moral hypothesis to develop this in your work, to insert that moral hypothesis at the beginning and at the end, that a business outcome is certainly a concrete, measurable, and necessary thought exercise, but it's not synonymous with a moral hypothesis. And by moral hypothesis, again, I mean what will people feel, think, do, and become that they would not feel, think, and do, and become before your solution existed? That's, for me, a very powerful consideration, because it leads right into innovation. It leads right into big thinking, which is what I teach a class at UCLA, and I think a lot of people drop out because they're like, hey man, I just want to learn wireframes, you know what I mean? Like, I just easy on the big yes, you know? I just came here to learn a little spec writing, you know, and God bless them. But what I am trying to encourage and to rhetorically evangelize is that you guys are the future. You are the smartest people that I know. And I say that not to butter anyone's toast. I say it because you're the most interdisciplinary people that I've ever met. You take in more information than probably anyone I've ever known. You have a sense of the humanities, or you wouldn't be in UX. You like people. You're even though actually I like humanity and I don't like people, I think I'm one of those people. But no. So this is really important. You are the people that are actually well equipped for the future to define these problems. And with that, what I'm arguing for is that you think like a founder and not a designer. All the impactful businesses today, you know, if you trace it to even these three guys, are these guys are designers. They're not. They're entrepreneurs after the fact. And why are they designers? Because they are defining the root problem. And I think, as Eric was mentioning, you know, you come into an organization where those root problems have already been worked out, and you're inheriting those problems, and you're making the best of it. In a lot of cases, we're putting lipstick on a pig. But I don't care if it doesn't happen at your job, then do it on the side, create a salon. This is our opportunity to use our skills, not to wait until chief executives say, okay, we'll bring a design seat at the table. It should be the other way around. We should bring them at the table, because we actually are thinking about the world in a really profound way. So what that means also is, as the innovation axis goes up, we are designing the business. We're designing the business, not for it. And that's a powerful thing. That means if you're designing the business, you're designing its core offering, its services, that you are actually getting deeper into ground zero of the problem. And then finally, turn it over to Chris. You know, I recently saw a documentary on James Foley. It was really moving, and it also got me thinking about his definition of moral too. And so if I am suggesting that moral imagination is grounded in empathy, I also think it's grounded in courage. And as he says, if he doesn't have moral courage to challenge authority without reprisals of his career, then he doesn't have journalism. I would say the same thing about design. We have to become a little bit more fearless. If we think we're going to get fired, fine. This is a good employment environment for us. You'll get another job. So to develop that courage, and you know, you don't have to be a dick. You can just be more courageous and say what you really think. And if they don't get it, that just means that they don't get it. That's the wrong culture for you. So that's it. And I'm gonna turn it over to Chris. Thank you very much.
What's up, World IA Day? You need to understand something. The world is not like it is, not like it was, sorry. And soon it will likely be unrecognizable to those of us born too early. We've entered the age of wonders and terrors. The future is here already. Sometimes I think we're just counting heartbeats until the singularity. But then, you know, I also think that those rocket cars are coming any day now, so I could be wrong. In this age where the machines of our creation surely, if slowly, remove the need for human labor, a question I obsess about is, what is it that humans do best? Personally, I think it's storytelling. I'm pretty sure machines will soon be telling good stories, don't get me wrong, but storytelling is the uniquely human invention that lets us come together to form cultures and societies, you know, groups larger than the bands that we hunted and gathered in on the plains of Africa, sort of like the global nerd party I see before me today. First, a little storytelling about me. My slides are not in the right order, which is typical of me if you're familiar with my style. I've spent my professional life grappling with the future, trying to point out that the internet or social or mobile was going to change things, and that my clients, my stakeholders, friends and family, the occasional Uber driver, they'd better be ready. I worry constantly that I'm going to wake up one day and not understand anything about the world around me. And actually, it's already happening. The other day, I realized that I didn't understand smoking. I opened my eyes and there's all these vape shops on every corner. I was like, I have no idea what goes on in a vape shop. How did that happen? I didn't have the slightest idea. Because of this concern, or maybe the other way around, but I'm a big yes kind of guy. I say yes to anything that comes along, a fact that has made me the butt of plenty of jokes. Remember chat roulette? Sure, I tried it for a couple of days. I'll tell you about it some other time. So I try to say yes, and then later I decide what to say no to. I'm not saying that's right, mind you. I'm just telling you that's how I approach things. Because, you know, the future isn't what I thought it would be. Years ago, when I was asked by a recruiter what technologies I was comfortable with, I said all of them. But now I'm not so sure. For one thing, I am pathetic at Snapchat. Oh my god! But I'm still probably better than most of you. I don't see any teenagers, too many teenagers out there. You probably already gotten religion on a mobile first point of view, but is that enough? It took me several tries to get it right. The first Disney World app that I worked on, I designed it and it assumed a mobile context, because of course it was obvious to me that people would only want to use the app while they were in the park. Duh. Let me ask you this, do you talk to your devices? Because you will. I've spent years designing for these little tiny rectangles and being really frustrated at how limiting they are, but now I just don't see that it's really that important in what's coming up for us. Do you expect the world to anticipate your needs? Because you should. Have you thought about how your product or service can be integrated into Google Now, or Siri, or Alexa, or I suppose even Cortana? Are you ready for the world of messaging? I read a lot about WeChat and Line, and I use WhatsApp and Facebook Messenger, but I don't really understand, I don't really get it, like how all the things that I do now in apps and websites and on devices really will take place in the absolute context of messaging. If you're like me, you've read 100 articles about the Internet of Things, and you're right to be skeptical, but how many smart things are you surrounded by right at this very moment? Is there any way that this doesn't continue and to grow exponentially? Let me ask you this. Do you have a drone strategy? Oops, my slides. Do you have a drone strategy? What about a driverless car strategy? And I don't even know what to say about what's going on in the world of massive online gaming. I can't wait to hear more from Jamila about how marvelous a world is it where you build a game and then millions of people play this game and then they start joining leagues and playing a game themselves and competing, and you start off with a game and then pretty soon you have to build FIFA, or anyway, hopefully a more moral version of FIFA. And honestly, a lot of this talk is embarrassing to me. I mean, honestly, I've done my work has all been to help people enjoy a theme park, or get to your movie theater a little bit quicker, or maybe help you flip a house. You know, now that I think about it, I kind of wish I hadn't let Jod go first. But there is good news. In some ways, the game for us hasn't changed at all. There are parts of our work that are timeless. We're still working hard to figure out how to go from data to information to knowledge to wisdom. And, you know, unfortunately, another part that hasn't changed is that we're going to still argue about the metaphor that we use about how we get there. Are we engineers? Are we architects? Are we designers? I, of course, now aspire to be a wisdom choreographer. Another bright spot among the chaos to me is that we've learned a lot about the right way to build products and services. Marrying design thinking to agile and lean, it presents challenges, but getting things in front of people faster and learning faster and just going faster with a prototyping and the right mindset about MVP, well, I think that's usually the right way to go. Well, let me switch now and talk a little bit about a larger journey, the hero's journey of the information architect. You start off with a goal to accomplish, an assignment, a mission. You are presented with a mess, and you must make it better. As a fool, well, a holy fool anyway, you set off on your journey. You leave the Shire, or the swamp, if you're Shrek, with a wonderful false sense of security based on what you think you know about the world. As Socrates said, true wisdom comes to each of us when we realize how little we understand about life, ourselves, and the world around us. You meet a teacher. Sometimes this is obvious, sometimes it's not. It could be a research subject. It could be a stakeholder. It could be a mentor, or a peer, or a boss, or honestly just some random jackass. One weird thing about this journey is that you won't always know who the teacher is when you meet them. Sometimes what they have to tell you is clear and compelling, and sometimes it is totally up to you to make sense of it. Of course, you encounter obstacles along the way. For one thing, the problem is not right. No matter what the problem is you've been given, it isn't the right problem. Your first obstacle is to discover what the actual problem is. Through your hard work, diligence, training, luck, you shine a light in the darkness of the cave. You discover the perfect label, the value proposition, the perfect structure, the greatest plan, the solution. Oh, you know you're right. But now the challenge really begins. Because when you endeavor to create something new and good, the world will rise up against you. They will question your judgment, your methods, your experience, your sample size. You're plagued by self-doubt. The signal that seemed so clear to you before is maybe more ambiguous than you thought. You hear rumors of war. You think, I'm afraid. I'm a fraud. I don't know any of this for sure. What if I'm wrong? What if they discover I don't know what I'm doing? How do you prepare for this confrontation? Well, by thinking ahead, you plant seeds, you build consensus around personas, you marshal diagrams of power like journey maps, you secure data to support your point of view. It's best to approach the real problem fully prepared, but usually you won't be. And really, all any of us can do is do our honest best. And the truth is you won't win most of the time. Nobody does. A baseball player who gets a hit 3 times out of 10 is an all-star and possibly a Hall of Famer. Most of the time, you'll strike out. Your kick will go wide. Your car will get towed. Maybe you make a tactical retreat. After all, she who fights and runs away lives to fight another day. There's no shame in this. Believe me, you better rest up and go easy on yourself, because you're going to have to do it all again and strap that armor on again next week or tomorrow. And sometimes you do win. You pull the sword from the stone. You use the force and lob that torpedo right down the service hatch. You sneak the ring past the evil eye and drop it into a volcano. The team loves your solution and launches into the world like a newborn. You return home a hero, forever changed by your encounter with reality. And you've gained something important. You've taken data and turned it into information, which you've structured to support and enhance the knowledge of the human beings who are standing in the path of this data tsunami. But, and this is a big but, it will decay. None of us escapes the second law of thermodynamics. The system you created may not be maintained. The structure will be modified beyond recognition. The new features you carefully planned for will get axed. Oh, life is a toil and love is a trouble. Beauty will fade and riches will flee. Wages will dwindle and prices will double, and nothing is as I would wish it to be. And that's okay. Thank you. It's how it's meant to be. Because here's the thing, there are two paths to wisdom. The first isn't actually a path, by the way, because wisdom is available to you as it is to any child. Buckminster Fuller said, the universe is trying its hardest to help you succeed, but you do have to realize that you aren't the only experiment. Maybe this seems like mysticism, and maybe it is, but help is all around. And if you're quiet and calm and mindful in the moment, you can flow like water, or like a leaf upon the storm, and thread that needle to victory. The other path to wisdom is experience. By following your journey, playing your part, and giving of yourself time and again, you can slowly transmute the lead of experience into the gold of wisdom. And then, inevitably, you die. But maybe, just maybe, the machines will tell their stories about you. Thank you.
I think we can take a few minutes for some questions. I'm sure folks are going to have some interesting ones.
You guys like the transition master.
I don't know, John, Chris, you guys want to come up? Here, I'll get out of the way.
There's no questions. That was like a mic drop, right?
Please use the mics for the questions, okay, if you have questions.
Hey guys, great talks. So they were very deep, deep talks. All right, so this is the thing, is that when you join a company, right, some companies have a very strong belief. They have values and vision. And some companies forget about their value and vision, what they started with. And then you show up as well, and you have your own vision and values, and you also forget those vision and values too. So, occasionally you'll match up and you'll join a company that you really believe in. And sometimes you'll match up with a company where you don't believe what the company does, yet you're there and you're doing work and you're like, okay, cool. You said something about, designers are there to change the business rather than be there for the business. How does that work? I mean, I can show up at a company and I may disagree. I'm like, this is such boring work. I don't believe these guys are producing great change in the world. Should I fight to bring my change, my vision for the future in every project that I do? Or am I there to exist for the company and to bring that company's vision to life? Does that make sense? And be like, all right, you know what? Thank you so much for giving me this job and opportunity. I'll do the best work I can as a designer to make this product awesome. So is it designers are there to make the product awesome, or designers are there to make stuff that they believe in awesome?
I don't know the answer.
Wow. He dodged a bullet. That's a great question. Part of the, when I talk to designers starting out and they're like, well, I gotta move up. And I'm like, okay, well, why do you want to move up? Right? Well, I'll get paid more, obviously, I guess, or I don't have to do wireframes as much. Those are all good things too, but really, you have to sort of enjoy making the argument, right? And it's scary because making that argument means there is an opposing point of view, most likely, right? And so I'm not saying that the only answer is to simply get promoted, but I'm saying that think of the trajectory, an upward trajectory of your career, as less about, I have to do it for the sake of doing it, and more about, if I can have an upward ascent in my career, I can be more influential. And that's the beauty of it, right? And you'll also be incredibly frustrated because, it still doesn't guarantee that your influence will be integrated, but
it certainly gives you a better fighting chance. Now, that being said, the only thing I would add to it is just, you know, I believe every designer should exhibit some degree of leadership, because, especially UX, because we are that connective tissue, we are the facilitators, we are the communicators, and that is actually a skill that you can't teach. And so we are leaders, and we are leaders of our deliverables. So I would just say, look for a place that is culturally, you know, as motivated as you are or you're aligned with. And if you're not in that place, of course, you're going to make the best of it. We all have rent to pay, mortgage to pay. And if it's not being met at work, do a product on the side, because that is why you got into this field. So
that's a horrible answer. No, I'm just kidding. I mean, I agree with all that. I guess I would just say, I think what motivates a designer is a frustration with the world as it is and a desire and a vision that the world can be better. That's why I get all the complaints about why are designers always cranky, right? Because I try to explain to people all the time, right? You don't understand. They live in the world that we all live in, and they can see a better one. And they don't understand why we don't live in that better one. So I don't think in the long run you can really be effective as a designer if you're not trying to make things as good and as strong and as positive as you can be. That being said, no judgment if you happen to find yourself in a place. We all have times in our lives when, you know, that's not an option, and we're making, you know, you got to choose your battles. But, you know, I think fundamentally you need to be at a place where you're making things better, or you should be looking around. Because, as John said earlier, it's a great time to be looking around. So, you know, if you're frustrated by that, yeah, don't be.
You said something really key, which is, as a designer, you see something better. And that's the whole thesis of what we've talked about today. It's that seeing something better. And it doesn't mean that it's the answer, but that's why they hire you, because you have this ability to imagine a preferred future. And if you lose connectivity to that, you're executional only, and you'll be unsatisfied.
I have a two-part question. The first part is, do you think there are experts in an ever-changing field by the hour? And also, for philosophy, I know that one of their requirements was coding for everyone that they employed. And as you spoke, that a lot of the future is moving not only to our mobile devices, but also just talking with, you know, our instruments around us. Do you still feel that is necessary for designers to code?
I got so distracted by the second part of the question, I lost track of the first. So I'll start with the second. I think that I do believe at Philosophy that everybody codes. It's not just the designers, everybody codes. The product owners and product managers code. I had to learn how to, you know, commit my bio to the website on Git. It was a little traumatic, but I got through it. I wanna just make one point of emphasis though, right? Like, the idea is not everybody is equally good at everything, because that's ridiculous, right? That's not what we're saying. What we're saying is that we work in a medium, and that you need to be familiar with the materials that you're designing. And so you need to be interested to learn how to code. As you know, I've spent a lot of my career prior trying to figure out how the designers work better with the developers, right? And how the developers work better with the designers. And I honestly believe one way is for the designers to do more development and for the developers to do more design. So just so you know, just as uncomfortable as we are by having to learn how to code, they have to learn how to design. So they also aren't cool about that. Again, I forgot part one. Sorry, just right. Totally.
I think we could keep going with a lot of really good conversation about this. I'm going to ask folks to hit you up during the break and later, you know, afterward, because we're a little behind, and I don't want to take time off from, I don't want to cut time out of our presenters at the latter part of the day. So let's thank John and Chris again for their really thought-provoking time. And we can go and enjoy a nice, get some break, have a snack. Perficient has provided our afternoon snack. Woohoo! And they have a nice group of people here ready to meet you out by the snack area. And sign up for after parties or dinners on the, you'll see the sheets on the outside doors. Thanks.